Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Jeffrey Bryan, Associate Director of Comparative Oncology for Ellis Fischel Cancer Center and the Cancer Research Lead for Next Generation Precision Health. Welcome to the fourth session of our Next Gen Precision Health Discovery Series. These discussions are intended to keep us all updated on Next Gen progress, as well as to highlight precision health developments in cross-cutting topics that are essential to our collaborative success. Today, it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker on a vitally important topic. Dr. Fungai Chanetsa serves as the Associate Director for Research Administration at the Ellis Fischel Cancer Center. She is presenting us a value proposition on team science. Her message is centered on how the knowledge gained from team science can be used to deliver a high return on investment for the University of Missouri System's research enterprise. She will define what team science is and what it is not, highlight the benefits, opportunities, and strategies to facilitate adoption of team science practice, and share how to make these ideas actionable. She joined us having previously worked for 15 years as a health behavior scientist and a scientific review officer at the National Institutes of Health Center for Scientific Review. She has served as director of the Behavioral Risk Research Unit and project director of the Missouri Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance System. As an associate professor at Northwest Missouri State University, she studied diabetes management, focusing on physical activity and diet in African-American women using geographic information systems to study the relationships between the physical environment and health outcomes in underserved populations. Dr. Chanetsa previously was the senior lecturer at the University of Zimbabwe and conducted research on cardiovascular risk factors in a population in health transition. Today, Dr. Chanetsa will explore with us how team science has become essential to scientific progress as societal problems and the technologies to solve those problems become more complex. Team science efforts will empower our faculty to engage and lead interdisciplinary teams to position our university system at the cutting edge of scientific research and to be more competitive in securing extramural research funding. And with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Fungai Chanetsa.
Thank you, Dr. Bryan. I appreciate everyone being here today and to engaging in this important conversation about team science and how we can leverage team science to enhance our value here at MU. So for much of the 20th century, biomedical research could be thought of as a cottage industry with small groups working on tightly focused projects directed by a single lab leader. Even as the NIH budget and mission grew dramatically, the organizing unit of federal support remained the principal investigator. And this worked and produced many of the scientific and medical advances that formed the foundation of the modern biomedical enterprise. While it is unlikely that the individual investigator is in danger of extinction, it became increasingly clear that to solve the many problems that face us today requires collaborative efforts across disciplines. So the success of the Human Genome Project has also made this very clear with the amassing of the massive accumulation of omics data, presaging bioinformatics, and the integration of mathematics, physical science, and engineering into biological problem solving, opening up the idea of a variety of approaches that are available to biologists and medical researchers. So the value proposition today really is that much of the complex work in the modern world is performed by teams. And for this requires many different moving parts in collaboration that require foundational skills in the practice of team science, making it essential for more effective collaborative problem solving while engaging in science teams. I would like to really make sure that we're all on the same page about what we mean by team science as opposed to the science of team science. And then I will make a case that I think is compelling for team science practice here at MU and the MU system and discuss some of the opportunities that present us, the challenges and barriers, and strategies that we can use to facilitate and support team science, and then answer questions at the end. So what is team science? is the collaborative effort that leverages the strength and expertise of professionals with training from different fields to address the scientific challenges. So more than one individual working together interdependently, it could be small scientific teams or larger groups with a variety of disciplinary composition or interdisciplinary integration, and a range of perspectives that could be scientific, industry, and community stakeholders working concurrently. This is as opposed to working in science teams, which is really more of a legacy of structures of academia, where the sources of support, rewards and incentives, and success metrics and motivation for collaboration really engendered competition as opposed to collaborators. So the scientific research team in this context, really think of it as a continuum that ranges from low to high integration, where you have from one end of the low end is the investigator-initiated research, where the investigator works largely independently on a research problem in their own lab. In the middle here, we have some collaboration with each group member bringing expertise to address a problem and group members working on separate parts of the research problem, which are later integrated. And the data sharing and brainstorming that occurs among lead investigators varies from limited to frequent. Whereas the integrated research team, each team member brings a specific expertise to address the research problem. Teams must meet regularly to discuss team goals and individual objectives and next steps. And they share leadership responsibility and decision-making authority, data and credit. And frequently, new leaders emerge as spawned from ideas within the context of the initial collaboration. So we can think of interdisciplinary research in a continuum of integration, right? With unidisciplinary research ranging from a single discipline working together to address a common problem, with all multidisciplinary groups of researchers with different disciplines working sequentially from their own disciplinary perspective with a goal of eventually combining results to address a common problem, to interdisciplinary research where different disciplines are working jointly to address a common problem with some integration of perspective occurring, but contributions remaining largely in their own disciplines. The ideal that we want to strive for is working from a disciplinary perspective where we are jointly developing and using a shared conceptual framework that synthesizes and extends discipline-specific theories, concepts, and methods. Think of it this way. You have a group of people who go into a sandbox and each brings their toys, right? And they play all day. At the end of the day, in interdisciplinary research, the individuals take their toys home with them. With transdisciplinary research, however, they play with toys, exchange toys, and when they go home, they are using they take toys that they didn't bring in the first place, therefore creating a new paradigm and a way of thinking in a new perspective. The science of team science is really a generation of evidence-based understanding how scientific teams organize, communicate, and conduct research. It results in the development of problem solving from a methodological and a technological perspective where applications can be designed in order to address the dynamics of team science research. So what the added value of the science of team science is that it helps us to ask and answer new questions and produce more comprehensive knowledge and generate more effective applied solutions to allow teams to successfully work together. It helps us to understand processes and communications and coordination approaches that help to maximize scientific innovation and productivity. And we can characterize and determine those skills of team leaders and team members that helps to facilitate successful team functioning. And it can help us to answer questions of how funding agencies and universities can most effectively facilitate and support team science in order to advance discovery, and what policies need to be changed or are needed in order to facilitate team science. So here is the plethora of evidence-based approaches that are accessible and available for really enhancing and facilitating team development and sustaining success of team science groups. So the case that I would like to make for team science is that boundary spanning collaborations result in greater scientific impact. So we see that although the number of departments might have a negative effect on specific or type of innovation, the impact and on the impact, prior experiences among team members reverses this effect. So the collaboration that occurs organically and naturally engenders successful team science collaboration. Within universities, publications with authorship teams that are spanning different universities produce higher impact work than comparable co-located teams or solo scientists. And across countries, international teams and teams from varied locations generally yield higher impact publications, with certain countries, for example, in the US and universities that are research one, increasing the likelihood of positive impacts and external funding. So what we learn is that generally collaborations that span organizational and contextual boundaries enhance the impact of the research. Disciplinary diversity and cross-disciplinary teams also enhance impact of team science. It is found to be more productive than comparison teams as indicated by publications in high impact journals. They produce more innovative products than unit disciplinary teams, and they tend to generate publications with greater scientific impact. There is also greater cross-fertilization via publications with broader reach and decreased specialization because everyone is adapting and using perspectives from other fields. And there's also identification of new and previously unexplored areas of the intersections of different fields and domains. So we see that cross-disciplinary teams are more productive, more innovative, yield greater scientific impact, and result in broader dissemination of results. So the role of roles differentially influence team science effectiveness. We find that postdocs with external funding and inclusion of graduate students and technicians increases the likelihood of breakthrough publications. And postdocs, specifically with project funding, have higher productivity. Senior co-authorships with higher rank have publications in higher impact journals than articles that are co-authored by junior researchers on their own. Therefore, the positive effects on both collaboration and productivity by including varieties of expertise, varieties of levels of academic careers. So the inclusion of different types of roles on teams impacts team effectiveness, resulting on different kinds of outcomes. And some of the practical considerations we might want to think about, why do we see these differences? How can we better align team configuration with goals that we have? What about stakeholder involvement? How do we engage them? And I will talk a little bit about this as we go on in this talk. So we see that when trainees are engaged in transdisciplinary research, they discover new transdisciplinary areas of research, therefore influencing or altering research interests. It transforms them into transdisciplinary researchers, both by working in the intersections between disciplines and using transdisciplinary methodological approaches. And it facilitates new collaborations and innovative transdisciplinary research. They are more successful in obtaining grants that support career advancement. And this experience makes them more competitive on the job market. And because they now can engage research topics and methods and that are varied, and they can participate in teamwork through grant writing applications and manuscript preparation. So what we see is that the complexity of the problems we face today is has increased the diversity of of disciplines that we can engage from discovery, translational to clinical to public health at the same time, as opposed to sequentially. It has also shifted the way agencies address funding and focusing more on initiated, focusing from individual initiated research to interdisciplinary science teams. So think about the diversity of disciplines that had to be, I'm having a problem of multiple screens here. I apologize for this. So think of the diversity of disciplines that had to come together to drive the pace at which the COVID vaccine was developed. These were teams in different spaces around the world. And what is different is the way that we think about team science and the curation and choreography that took place to challenge the way we think about team science and how to do it successfully. So if this could be pulled off for a novel virus, imagine what we could do with a planned initiative such as NextGen. So this was really driven by the urgency of the need, the global nature of this need, and disparities in burden, that with a lot of injection of funding really hastened the pace for the response to the pandemic, for discovery, development, implementation, and the vaccine program, and also other studies that are ongoing to determine how we can best distribute resources and vaccines. So a lot of communication is going on in order to put all these pieces together. And this is the true ideal team science thinking that's taking place. So another example is the evolution of tobacco research from a silo approach of groups of disciplines independently working in silos. So for example, we had geneticists searching for inherited traits, molecular biologists searching for the effects of nicotine on neurotransmitters, and psychologists examining traits, and behaviorists working on quit lines, and pharma on approaches to quit smoking. So the heightened recognition of the public concern of cigarette smoking as the largest preventable cause of mortality and morbidity led to the development of the transdisciplinary tobacco use research centers. This initiative brought together researchers from multiple disciplines, including pharmacology, genetics, psychology, neuroscience, and behavioral science, among others. So by integrating varied approaches and methods across disciplines and fields, they enhanced the potential to accelerate scientific advances to produce more comprehensive and effective solutions to nicotine addiction. It goes without saying that the initiative has generated millions of dollars in funding for the groups involved in this initiative. Another example is obesity, right? It engages a complex web of societal, biological factors and energy balance at the center of over 100 variables grouped in 7 cross-cutting themes that directly or indirectly influence energy balance. The National Center Institute's Transdisciplinary Center initiative was an acknowledgement for the need and relevance for novel approaches to knowledge creation and integration across disciplines to solve this complex problem. The objective is to foster collaboration across multiple disciplines to encompass projects that cover biology, genomics, genetics of energy balance, to behavioral, sociocultural, and environmental influences on nutrition, activity, weight, energetics, and cancer risk. In this respect, transdisciplinary research has transformed the way that researchers leverage computational and technological innovations and merging insights from historically distinct disciplines in life sciences and engineering to create new pathways and opportunities for simultaneously solving the same problems. And I would like to note that in this whole paradigm, social sciences and humanities have remained untapped resources, especially in biomedical research. So what we see are broader impacts of participation in transdisciplinary research being adoption of a transdisciplinary ethic and approach, which results in new boundary crossing in collaborations, which has hastened scientific progress, which has in turn influenced career development paths and advancement. It has also influenced how institutions and culture to change in at the same step as medical advances and developments. So the value proposition here is that NextGen is a catalyst for interdisciplinary team science research, right? Because of the size of the scope of today's problems and the fast pace of advancement in specialized technology, scientific research collaboration is increasingly becoming the norm, in which teams must work interdependently and cross boundaries to achieve shared goals for addressing these challenges. So the value opportunity that we have here in partnership with NextGen are many rich resources across MU and the UM system, right? We have the NextGen Precision Health and all of the resources that comes with it. We have the potential, the Ellis Fisher Cancer Center Consortium partnership with Siteman with NCI designation for the Ellis Fisher Cancer Center. We know that NCI designation for any center attracts philanthropic support, with centers reporting fourfold increase in the first 5 to 10 years. It enhances clinical marketing branding ability, with centers reporting 10% growth in patient volume in the first year. It provides opportunities for research funding only available to NCI designated centers. And it facilitates recruitment of world-class doctors and scientists and fuels partnerships with pharma, biotech, and biotech companies. In addition, the UM system also has commitment to leadership in precision health and investments in translational research through state-of-the-art next-gen facilities, equipment, and cluster hires and programmatic recruitment. We have a full complement of co-located colleges and schools with an opportunity for transdisciplinary cancer research across all of them. We have 4 campuses across the state. We have the UM Extension Program that has presence in every county in the state. We have the partnership with the VA for clinical trials, and we have the University of Missouri Research Reactor, which bridges expertise of MU and the UM system to industry partnership. So we see that we have a very rich opportunity and unique opportunity with NextGen to really leverage our capability for interdisciplinary research across all of these resources that we have available to us. NextGen is really an investment for accelerating science, a value opportunity to transform how we engage research, and for MU and the UM system to chart a path of excellence that could see our NIH funding portfolio exponentially increase. And to conduct research that has broader, faster impacts demands an approach to knowledge production and action that involves these diverse teams working together in novel ways, transcending disciplinary and organizational boundaries beyond the walls of the building of the NextGen facility. So we see the NextGen as a service center, a team science center that requires us to reimagine innovation and connecting across disciplines and entities across campus and across the system. It's a convergence, an ideas lab, and a fertile ground for collaboration beyond these physical walls, so that there's very, very strong potential for traditional and non-traditional collaborations from bench to community setting. NextGen opens an opportunity to approach these research differently and smarter. And this is team science thinking. And the approach that we've seen advance scientific progress and generate massive funding opportunities for these transdisciplinary tobacco use research centers in the NCI Transdisciplinary Center Initiative. Therefore, I envision that there will be collaboration across the various pillars and centers around common complex questions, across pillars in NextGen, across schools and colleges, and across the UN system. I'm sorry, I'm having trouble with this. I always do for some reason. Okay, so what are some of the challenges that we are faced, that face us today, right? We know that collaboration is complex. We have interpersonal issues. We require, as humans, we require familiarity and social cohesiveness and diversity, right? And we need to be flexible to changing these task requirements and environments and in communication and be able to enhance our psychological safety through mutual respect across colleagues, across colleges, across schools, right? There are intrapersonal issues, attitudes towards collaboration and willingness to devote time and effort to collaborate, activities, preparation for complexities, and tension inherent to interdisciplinary collaboration. And we need inclusive participatory empowering leadership styles. We have complexities in physical environment, proximity of members, access to comfortable meeting areas, resources for visual and auditory privacy, technological issues such as infrastructure readiness, data security, private access and retrieval, right? And member technical readiness. We have organizational complexities, right? That strong organizational incentives are needed to support collaborative teamwork and structures that facilitate team autonomy and goal setting and the breadth of disciplinary perspectives and frequent opportunities for interactions and information exchange. And I have to say, because of the pandemic, we are faced with a situation where the norms of interaction have really been disrupted, and we must be creative in how we approach collaboration in this context. So thankfully, perhaps with a little bit of vaccination and herd immunity, we can head back and being able to have those face-to-face interactions that allow us to create relationships that gives us comfort and confidence and safety to initiate collaborations. So some of the challenges in transdisciplinary team science really include conceptual and scientific challenges, lack of clarity about what transdisciplinary science is and how we get there, right? Transdisciplinary science stretches investigators' intellectual capacity more than unidisciplinary research because it takes us out of our comfort zones of what we are used to. And transdisciplinary research is more complex than unidisciplinary research because we need to devote time and invest time in understanding other disciplines and other languages in other disciplines and be able to apply them in a new way. Different disciplinary cultures among collaborators also enhance different values, language, and traditions. And also team members want to stay in their comfort zone because it's easier to know to stay with what we know than to learn new things because it requires less investment of time and we do not lose time in terms of if we're investing in transdisciplinary research, there's a learning curve that we have to go through, and at times it delays success. There are also management challenges, right? Transdisciplinary research requires more time, requires more resources, requires planning and management than unidisciplinary research. It requires compromise, change in routine, for example, in data management, in how we communicate, in how we approach problems. There's also physical distance that might be introduced, which means that there's going to be more communication challenges and that will slow progress in research. We also have challenges of incentives and recognition systems and academic norms, right? And many, because of the size of institutions, incentives have not caught up to transdisciplinary research, for example, promotion and tenure criteria and limited funding opportunities in publishing venues. Colleagues may be unfamiliar with transdisciplinary research. So for example, grant and manuscripts review may not be seen as positively or may not be reviewed similarly to unidisciplinary research. And there is also uncertainty about career arc, where the lack of established role models limits early career researchers from going into, from participating in transdisciplinary research, because it's viewed as something that might delay their tenure clock. So a phase where we are, okay? The challenges that we need to address include support to break down barriers across discipline and developing projects and new teams. So what can we do? We need to enhance readiness of teams. We need to provide foundational knowledge and skill building, team formation, idea generation, forecasting of scientific areas of need and interest, and align those with strategic capabilities and formation of collaborative teams, discussions, roundtables, workshops, meetings, special issues, commentaries can all enhance our skill building as well as team building. So what we need to do is to build on emerging evidence and lessons learned to effectively and efficiently advance science by using conceptual models, practical strategies, resources to help guide and support the conduct of research of the team and centers and initiatives that we embark on. So what are some of the strategies that we can use for stimulating new collaborations and innovation of ideas? Okay. So for knowledge building, we have toolkits that are highly accessible. They are online and they will be made available on a portal so that people can use some of the online modules to build developmental skills. There are many training modules that will be available. There are research networking tools that are available through ORED and facilitation. Importantly, we must continue evaluate and improving on this process in order to ensure success, right? We can also create new collaborations through research networking tools, seed funding, structured processes, and strategic priorities that are geared towards collaborative teams. Our long-term positioning planning will use competitive intelligence to identify and connect potential collaborators and generate new ideas and strategic visions and programs of research by identifying relevant opportunities and gearing them towards collaborating teams and large collaborative grants through the NIH, NSF, Department of and National Academy of Sciences. And the new grant funding can be stimulated through scientific retreats, often with speed dating style networks, have been shown to increase the return on the dollar by tenfold, right? So each retreat, for example, is approximately $5,000. This is in the time of face-to-face meeting. This can generate tens and thousands of and millions of dollars from different groups that can generate ideas from such retreats. So we could have retreats where different groups meet together in speed dating style networking sessions, brainstorming, and come up with ideas for research funding. And this can be done on a frequent basis to continue generating new ideas and supporting new teams. So what are some of the strategic considerations we can make, right? We need to determine what value are we looking for in our pilot or seed funding? Do we promote junior investigators? Do we promote centers? Do we promote senior investigators or collective projects across centers and among varied people of different levels of career trajectory? We can use ideas labs, centbeats, innovation labs, and seed dating But we need to make sure that we have a clear sense of what those goals are and tie those goals to next steps. So for example, provide seed funding to an ideas lab group so that they can develop preliminary data and then support them through the writing of a grant proposal and leverage the preliminary data for external funding. So we need to also be looking at what does success look like, right? We know that things may feel harder or seem to fall before they succeed. We know that embarking on transdisciplinary research, initially there is a delay in outcomes as opposed to unidisciplinary endeavors. However, over time, they catch up and we find that transdisciplinary research results in broader and faster outputs. So how do our researchers respond to these new challenges? And what happens to their confidence and enthusiasm to doing integrative transdisciplinary team science research? And what predicts their likelihood of continuing? All of this evaluation and data collection can help us to strengthen our capabilities for team science as we move forward. So what are some of the considerations that we need to make, right? What do we need to advance science and address our complex health challenges? Do our recognition and reward systems align with those needs? And how can we help to better align recognition and rewards with those needs? What are the opportunities that we have in front of us to shift our culture? And how can we provide structure to guide those changes? Do we know what we need to know to offer clear guidance on the team science initiative? So the take home here is that what works is being open-minded about interdisciplinary research, right? We need to also remember that team members need time to meet and interact in order to build relationships, because relationships matter. People have to trust each other in order to trust each other with our data and our ideas. We need to remember that teams, if we are following a distributive leadership responsibility style. So I mentioned earlier that in integrated team science, right, leadership evolves over time and changes, and different leaders emerge as different offshoots of projects arise from the initial work. What doesn't work is really focusing only on the outcome and not paying attention to the process itself, right? And assuming that people know or expecting people to come to know how to work as a team. Therefore, the need to provide the process to build foundational knowledge and skills to be able to be leaders and team members in team science. And what doesn't work is to believe that people are interchangeable. So for example, a team member leaves, and what it requires is an examination of the team dynamics and understanding the type of member that would fit in that collaborative group, and not merely thinking that, okay, we lost an engineer, therefore we need to replace with an engineer. So people are not interchangeable. We have to look at the dynamics of the team, the characteristics of the team. This is really only the surface of what team science entails. As I indicated, there's an entire science of team science that studies the way teams communicate, the way teams build, the way team leadership works, and many other facets of team science that we need to build in order to build successful collaborative teams, in order to leverage this unique resource that we have, that's NextGen. So there are several resources available that are accessible online that anyone can access in order to learn more about team science. And here are some of them and links to them that one can access. And actually, the Northwestern University is an incredible online module that one can take at your leisure. And it starts from the beginning into different facets as it advances through the modules. So I will stop here and now take questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chanetsa. Okay, I do have one question in, and I'd like to invite everyone that's on the call to please submit your questions in the Q&A section, and we'll get those over to Dr. Chanetsa. The first question is, what is the optimal size in a team science group? What is the team dynamics? Example, is there a leader for the team? What is the best mix of disciplines? 2, 3, 4 plus different disciplines?
So research has shown that 6 is the optimal number that makes for a well-functioning interdisciplinary team. However, they can be larger groups. And within those larger groups, then they can be offshoots of different teams working on different projects. And in team science, really, there is no one leader, as I indicated. Leadership is determined on where the project is, what type of project is in play, which skills are the best for that project that's underway. And leadership it evolves over time. So I talked about distributive leadership that really takes into account, depending on the pace of where the project is going, the type of project, different offshoots of project, the needs of the project, for example, the technology, the resources, that really determines who is leading at any point in time in an interdisciplinary project. So it is not really a top-down leadership style that works in team science.
Thank you so much. I would like to invite anyone to submit an additional question. We don't have any more questions on here. And so you can still submit one, but I'm going to thank you, Dr. Chanetsa, and I have a question that came in. Do you have team building suggestions for junior researchers who are new to the institution? Is there a timeline for how long it realistically takes to build a team?
I don't know whether one could say there is a specific timeline. It really depends on how you build relationships, because as I indicated, collaboration requires a certain amount of trust and relationship building. So depending on whether a new person already knows individuals at the institution or other people that they can collaborate with. So it really depends on the relationship that one already has or the mentors that the individual has. So there are many, many variables that come into play, and it's really dependent on the individual. So I'm not sure that there's a timeline. However, I think that it's always important at a new institution to really seek out different individuals of mutual interest and start building relationships right away, as opposed to waiting. It's better to be proactive and start building those relationships quickly.
That's true. And someone else added, well said about team science and leadership. With your last answer, I wanted to follow up and ask, so with that idea of being a junior investigator coming on at MU, where do you think a good place to start? Would it be to talk with your chair, or would it be to reach out to someone like you who is talking about team science? Where's a good place to start to build those relationships quickly, like you mentioned?
So I think that building relationships, there are many different perspectives, obviously, about building relationships. So reaching out to those various individuals that you mentioned, your chair, a person like me, the Office of Research, they have many different avenues there. There's professional development through the Office of Research. And I think that some of their professional development might be including team science. So different mentors, colleagues in the department. So it could be anywhere where one feels comfortable seeking out some guidance on how to approach this.
I think that's really great. And I just would also mention, as you talked about the Office of Research and Development, that they have research interest groups that Sheila Grant, if anybody on this call, could reach out to, and that they're getting groups together for different topic areas. So I have another question on here. Trust and respect with commitment toward a common goal are the foundation for an effective team. Have any teams been formed yet for NextGen? I actually can take some of this in that we do have some NextGen teams that we've started, one on addiction science. We have ALS, some different neuroscience ones that are going on. And so you can always reach out to me or the main email box for NextGen to ask about that if you're interested in a team that's specific to NextGen. So to give you this, go on. Sorry.
So I also wanted to say, I imagine that even within those different interest groups, there would be a lateral and a vertical type of collaboration ongoing if we are to follow the transdisciplinary spirit, correct? So even across those disciplines, I imagine there will be some collaboration as well.
Great, thank you. Given your comments that it takes more time to successfully build a team for team science, and since building team science is a goal of MU with NextGen, should MU consider extending their tenure time clock for junior faculty? For example, Case Western Reserve University tenure time clock is 9 years rather than 7.
Well, so first of all, that question is beyond my pay grade, but I would like to acknowledge that yes, there are several institutions that have adjusted their P&T review processes and tenure clocks to adjust for team science. And so this is something that I think that our leadership may want to look at as well in order to encourage participation in team science.
Yes. What would be your advice for senior investigators that have a successful program and may not see the benefit of team science and help other juniors or less successful investigators with important assets that may have been missed, and also how to handle the time investment in doing this effort in team science?
So for senior investigators, and I think a lot of this depends on where one is in their promotion cycle, right? There are some senior investigators who are now full professors. They are no longer looking at any promotion opportunities. And I think that is a really good time to start mentoring and bringing and really looking at the pipeline behind them and develop them and developing these skills. For those who are in the middle, I think that I talked about how when you have a transdisciplinary team that engages a variety of people at different levels of their career, for example, fellows and postdocs, it really enhances the productivity of that team by engaging postdoctoral fellows, by engaging graduate students. And I think in teaching those who are junior to us, it really allows us to create a pipeline of potential biomedical researchers. We have a transdisciplinary lens to them. So I would encourage and urge them to invest some time in looking out for the pipeline behind us.
Oh, great, thank you. So I don't have any other open questions. There were a couple about the teams, what current opportunities there are with NextGen, and I've just invite anyone to email me and I can get the right people connected with the faculty research leads that are working with NextGen to get them involved in the different projects that we have going on. And so currently I have no other questions that I see coming in. And so I would like to thank you, Dr. Chanetsa, and everyone for attending today. We'd be most appreciative of your feedback and suggestions for future topics that you'd like to learn more about. So we ask that you take just a couple of minutes to complete the survey. It'll be emailed to you, or it's also in the chat. Next month, we welcome Dr. Wes Warren on June 8th, when he will present on the genomics core at MU and NextGen Precision Health. Thank you again, everyone.
Thank you.